All right, we are on to part five of the sermon series on bearing fruit. And just a quick recap, this is based off of 2 Peter 1, verse 5, or starting there, where it says, "For all, but also for this very reason, give all diligence and add to your faith virtue, to your virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, godliness brotherly kindness love." So if you do these things and they abound, you will not be barren or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And what we find here is there's an exact formula that's outlined for us here. And what we're doing with this series of sermons is we are unpacking this formula a piece at a time. It's not something that we have to guess, that what's written down here are a number of things to start with and a number of things to add to and to progress in. And we've gone through so far faith, and we've learned that faith is seeing the invisible as more real, or seeing the unseen. And two, faith requires you to follow the pillar of cloud and fire as it moves wherever it goes. And three, faith has four enemies that we must conquer. So we start out with faith and the relationship with our God. And then we went on to virtue, where we learned that virtue is excellence of character. It reflects God's character because God is virtuous himself. But we also learned that there's another meaning to this word. It carries the meaning of valor, like that of a warrior. So you have to have a vision of living with virtue, that you have to see that you're in the grandest adventure of life, more than any movie could portray to us. And you have to think of it as like you're one of David's mighty men as we do spiritual battle and as we navigate this adventure. This is also the meaning of the word, because when you look at it, they were mighty men of valor, mighty men of virtue, and it's in the languages around warriors. And then finally, we learn that virtue is active and outwards to others, that it will impact the lives of others, and it will glorify God when you do it. And then last time we went through knowledge, that first we learned three things about knowledge, that knowledge of God without living it isn't knowledge. It's called the way for a reason, and that's another word for it, the way, because it's a way of life. It's not just the head knowledge, because there were plenty of people who have head knowledge but did not live it. They did not have the knowledge of God. In fact, they did the opposite with that. And then we also talked about how knowledge isn't just knowledge about just the Bible. It's also about things about science and learning about things in this world. God created all these things. God designed all these things. God built all these things. He designed mathematics and physics and everything else that is around that. So when we talk about digging into knowledge, it's also knowledge of these things. It's not to remain uneducated or to be afraid of these things. Because if God created it, it can't contradict the Bible when it's true, when it's a real thing. And then we finally learn that knowledge never is obnoxious or harms other people, but it's always tempered with love. So we've gone through faith, we've gone through virtue, we've gone through knowledge. Let's talk about the next one in the list, which is self-control. Self-control, and if we look at what that means, we can look at the Greek word behind it. It means what it sounds like, I think we could probably guess. Self-control, it's the virtue of one who masters his desires and his passions, especially his sensual appetites. If you look at a word that it comes from, it means strong in a thing, being masterfully, masterfully good, figurative and reflexively, self-controlled, controlling your appetites, being temperate with your appetites, strong, robust, having power over, possessed of, mastering, controlling, curbing, restraining, controlling oneself. Right, if you think about this, the word I think is kind of self-evident. It says that there's going to be a lot of passions, there's going to be a lot of things in this world, and that will come at us. And to have self-control means to be temperate in all these things. Now, we've covered before, not in these series of sermons, but we've been through 1 John 2:16, that says, "All that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but it is of the world." We've talked about the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the past and what those things mean. And these are the things and the way the world and Satan and his ways come at us. He comes at us with the lust of the flesh, things that pull on our desires. It could be anything. It could be, drugs, alcohol, pornography these days. It could be anger. It's things that pull at our flesh that he wants us to give into these desires. Lust of the eyes are things that pull at your senses, things you see that you want. You want more and more of. A bigger house, bigger car, bigger this, more money, all those type of things. Lust of the eyes, you're gonna see things put in front of you to help to make you cave. Pride of life is another thing that is there, that's mentioned there. And that's the desire to have status, right? To be superior to other people, to have power, to have position, these type of things, you know, where you feel better than the next person for whatever reason that is. And we find that the Bible says these are the things that are put before us, and the way that Satan works on us is to pull at us with these things. There's a series of sermons I gave last year or year and a half ago on each one of those things that if you want to look those up, you can see. But when we look at self-control, self-control is the beginning of the antidote for these things. It's a control over oneself to not give in to those things, restraining, not to just go completely out and do those things. Can you imagine if self-control was not on this list of things? You know, what would it be for a Christian, or what would a life look like? But I think there's more we need to understand about self-control, because this sounds like, yeah, I know, I should not do certain things. But why is it that we actually end up doing them, though? You and I are human. You and I give into things. In fact, turn back to Colossians 2, verse 20. Let's read something here, because there's a scripture here that seems like it contradicts the idea of having self-control. Colossians 2, verse 20 through 23. Is this saying we shouldn't have self-control? Colossians 2:20 says, "Therefore, if you died with Christ from the basic principles of the world, why, as though living in the world, do you subject yourselves to regulations? Don't touch, don't taste, don't handle, which all concerning things which perish with the using, according to the commandments and the doctrines of men. These things indeed have an appearance of wisdom and self-imposed religion, false humility, and neglect of the body, but are of no value against the indulgence of the flesh." Is that saying we shouldn't be self-controlled? No, this is actually gives us some keys about self-control, and it's probably not exactly how we think about it, because this was the idea of, think of this like a monk in a monastery who pulls himself out of the world and away from every single thing. Don't touch, don't taste, don't interact. Don't be, faced with anything, and just live a life in a room with solitude with nothing in it. And it says, well, this may look like, may seem like, you know, very nice self-imposed religion, false humility, the neglect. But it says, these things are of no value. That's no value against the indulgence of the flesh. Put that person in the right circumstance, and they will cave. Put them in the right conditions, and they will cave. In fact, what did Paul say? He said, you know, he did what he didn't want to do. He tried and he did what he didn't want to do. And he called himself, oh, wretched man that I am. Right? This is what he labeled. He says, man, I am really trying, but I keep giving in to these things where I try and I don't quite do it. This is a human condition. This is a human condition. I always found it funny, but when I was at college, Ambassador College, I had a roommate, one of my best friends from Australia, John O'Donnell. I don't know if some people may know him. But in college, we had these prayer closets. So in each of the dorm, you had a closet where you could go on a little stool and you could, you know, close the door and pray. And he was a funny guy. He was always cracking jokes. But every once in a while, he would leave the door cracked open. And then he would just sit in there and he would pray, oh, wretched man that I am, at the top of his lungs. And there were some people in the dorm that thought, that is not funny. This is, you know, they got very serious about it. But he loved to tweak their noses about that. But I just remember him saying that, oh, wretched man that I am. But it's a true thing. Paul was saying that, man, you know what? There's things that the flesh pulls on us. They pull on us. They withdraw. That we end up doing things. And so when we read this idea of self-control, you know, what we need to understand about it is something different today, because self-control can't exist without some other things that are behind it. Self-control is not just about just resisting or white-knuckling it, where you're just holding on and that's all you do, I just have to, and then we cave and then we get all mad and upset and, you know, I'm a failure, and we kind of pull out and stop talking to people because we failed. No, self-control comes by a number of things, and this is what I like to talk about today. I think there's a different slice way to look at self-control, because we all struggle with this. We struggle with things over times, giving into things. And how do we actually add self-control? Well, today, let's learn three things about self-control as well. Just three things. There's a lot of things you could talk about self-control, but let me just cover three different things about self-control. First one is, to be self-controlled, you have to know who you are. To be self-controlled, you have to know who you are. And we'll see, because let me read you a story or tell you a story. It's the son of King Louis the 16th of France, way back when. Says, I'll just read this, it's not long. Many years ago, I heard the story of the son of King Louis the 16th of France. King Louis had been taken from his throne and imprisoned. His youngest son, the prince, was taken by those who dethroned the king. They thought that inasmuch as the king's son was the heir to the throne, if they could destroy him morally, he would never realize the great and grand destiny that life had bestowed upon him. They took him to a community far away, and there they exposed the lad to every filthy and vile thing that life could offer. They exposed him to foods, the richest of which would quickly make him a slave to his appetite. They used vile language around him constantly. They exposed him to lewd and lusting women. They exposed him to dishonor and trust. He was surrounded 24 hours a day by everything that could drag the soul of a man as low as one could slip. For over 6 months, he had this treatment, but not once did the young lad buckle under the pressure. Finally, after intensive temptation, they questioned him. Why had he not submitted himself to these things? Why had he not partaken? These things would provide pleasure, satisfy his lust, and were desirable, and they were all his for the taking. The boy simply said, I cannot do what you ask, for I was born to be a king. I cannot do what you ask, because I was born to be a king. And in that phrase, we find somebody who knew who they were. And this is the start of self-control. Like I said, we're not talking about just white-knuckling against things. We have to first understand who we are. Who are you? What is your destiny? Who are you? Turn back to Proverbs 31, verse 3. Proverbs 31, verse 3. This exact same concept of in this story was given in Proverbs 31, 3. From a mother to a son, declaring, this is who you are. Proverbs 31, verse 3. And this is probably one of the part we don't read the most, because this is the Proverbs 31 woman is the rest. But Proverbs 31 and verse 3, the mother says to the son, King Lemuel, do not give your strength to women, nor your ways to that which destroys kings. What are the ways that destroy kings? It says, it's not for kings, O Lemuel. It is not for kings to drink wine, nor for princes intoxicating drink, lest they drink and forget the law and pervert the justice of all the afflicted. Give strong drink to him who's perishing, and wine to those who are bitter of heart. Let him drink and forget his poverty and remember his misery no more. You see, what's being said here is there's a reason for self-control. You have to first know who you are. She's saying, you're a king. There are ways that bring kings down. How many leaders have you seen in the news who are brought down by some scandal, something? This is what she's saying. There are ways that destroy kings. Wine is one of those things that this is not for. You are to judge people in the righteous way, not forget the law, and to lead. Therefore, you need to know who you are, and you need to put these lusts and these other things away, is what she's saying. She's saying, you should say, I cannot do what you ask, for I was born to be a king, in the exact same way. Well, this is how we are to think. Turn back to 1 Peter 1, verse 13, the same exact way. Same exact way. 1 Peter 1, verse 13. It says, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts, as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Because it's written, be holy, for I'm holy. What is that a statement of? Why is there self-control here? Why do I do it? Would I do it if I read this? It says, the one who called us is holy. Be you holy too. He's holy. I mean, you be holy in your conduct, for I am holy. This requires you to know who you are. The reason to do it is to know who you actually are, that you are a king, that one day you will be a king. One of these days that you are this, you are the son or the daughter of the living God. And the one that you're the son and daughter of is holy. Therefore, you be holy too. We have to know who we are. Self-control just by itself, just white-knuckling it, isn't how it works. God gives us a vision of why we need to change, why we need to be different. And it starts with the foundation of knowing who you are. A child of God will know his or her father, what nature he has. And he will say, I cannot do what you ask, for I was born to be a king. My father is holy, and I will be holy. Turn over to 1 Thessalonians 5. 1 Thessalonians 5. The Bible always talks about self-control in the context of things like who you are. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 4. It says, but you, brethren, you're not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet of the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him, therefore comfort each other. You can see what he's saying. You are sons. Who are you sons of? You are sons of light and sons of the day. You're sons of God. You're sons of your king. You're sons of your savior. This is the reason why we cast off the other things. We're not sons and daughters of the other. We have to know who we are. You have to know who you are. That has to be strong in your heart. Just like the prince said, I cannot do what you ask, for I was born to be a king. This is my destiny. This is why I will not do these things. And we see this in the scripture time and time again. We also see this back, turn back to Daniel 1. Daniel 1's a great story. Just like the prince said in this physical human story, we also have the same type of stories in the Bible. The same type of a story is found in Daniel 1, verse 8. I'll just read part of it because we know the story mostly, but it says, Daniel purposed in his heart. So they were basically in a training academy where they were taken into captivity, and they took young, smart people who were able to learn very quickly, and they were trying to train them in a very, very intensive period of years so that they could serve before the king. Part of that training was that they had all this food and drink and stuff that was from the king, all these delicacies and wine. Daniel, breaking the middle of this, said he purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's delicacies. Defiling means that you could end up eating something that is you shouldn't be eating as food, that it's not one of the foods that you should eat, you know, the pork or other things that God says stay away from. And if he did, he would be defiling himself because all of these foods were rich. All these things had it in there. So Daniel clearly understood who he was, didn't he? What does it mean to defile? It means I have a son or a daughter of God. I have laws that I've been given, and I see myself that way, and I don't want to defile that. I'm not going to defile myself by eating these things. And it says, nor with the wine he drank. Therefore, he requested of the chief of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now, God had brought Daniel in favor and goodwill with the chief of the eunuchs. And right, and so what he did is he said, hey, just let us do this for a period of time and do a test where we eat vegetables and water over here and not all this other stuff. And if we're better off after 10 days, then great. And you know what? They did that, and they were better off. And you can see here that Daniel had to clearly understand who he was, who his God was. it's not just, you know, because the stuff that was presented was probably very great tasting and, you know, awesome and, you know, opulent kind of stuff. But Daniel had to understand clearly who he was to be able to say no to that. And what we see is because that he had a relationship and he knew his God, God blessed him greatly, right? In verse 17, it says, as for these four young men, God gave them knowledge and skill and all literature and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding and visions of dreams. And down in verse 20, it says, and in all manners of wisdom and understanding about which the king examined them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers who were in his realm. So, if you think about this, this is the idea of living with knowing who you are. The idea that you know you are a king. The idea that you know your God and that he is holy and you be holy. The idea that you have an identity that is so strong in you that that's the reason why you say, no, my God is holy. I have these things. I will be holy too. But I know who I am. I'm not going to do these things because I know who I am. Daniel and his friends were an example of that. And you can see how God backed them up just because of the choices and all that they did like this, because they understood this. Let's turn to one more, 2 Timothy 2, verse 19. On this first point, 2 Timothy 2, 19. Says, nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal. The Lord knows those who are his, and let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. But in a great house, there's not only vessels of gold and silver, but also wood, clay, some for honor, some for dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. Those who name the name of Christ depart from iniquity. If you know who you are, if you claim that Christ is your king, if you claim that you're part of that family, then you depart from iniquity. This is what it means to have your identity be the first thing you have to understand who you are to depart from that. Just like Daniel was used, it says here too that if you're a vessel, it's not for nothing. Right? Doing these things isn't like everybody else is out having fun and you're just here, woe is me. If you are doing this and you know who you are and you cleanse yourself and have self-control, then you will be, it says, a vessel for honor, sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. Just like Daniel and his friends, when they did it, God said, hey, I can use these folks to do amazing things. And look what, man, the story of Daniel, if you're ever a young kid, it's a great story to read, right? Because these were young men. And what they did was so far-reaching. And what we have written down in the dreams and the visions that God gave, they were vessels prepared for every good work. So it's not just, hey, I'm having no fun and everybody else is having fun. There is a purpose for this. When you understand who you are, when you cleanse yourself, when you have self-control, and that what God can do with you in those cases is something far-reaching. That's what 2 Timothy 2:19 talks about. Exactly that thing. That's what Daniel lived. That's what all the scriptures say. Whenever you read about scripture about self-control, it's always talking about it in the context of who you are. Do you know who you are? This is the first thing to fundamentally understand about self-control, is you must understand who you are. Otherwise, you're just doing something that's probably hard to keep doing. You're going to cave all the time. Let's understand to start with, to be self-controlled, you have to know who you are, step one. Very fundamental key to this. Step two, to be self-controlled, you have to have a vision of the future. To be self-controlled, you have to have a vision of the future. 1 Corinthians 15:19 is an awesome scripture. It's very real. It's a very real scripture. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 19. It says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. That's a great scripture. It says that if you're doing this and you're denying yourself these things and you have self-control and it only has to do with this life right here physically, there's nothing in the future, then we're miserable. We're the most miserable people you could imagine. So flip that around. It's saying the reason you deny the do these things is because there is a future, and you're looking at that future, and it's not just about this life right here. Man, the stuff that people do, they have tons of fun. There's tons of fun in it. It could be temporary, it could be fun for a period of time. You have to keep coming back to it, and it catches people in a loop, and hey. But you have to say, there's something more. The reason I deny myself of this is because what's coming in the future, I have to see the future. Otherwise, I'm going to be one of these miserable people who's like, oh, I can't go to your party, I need to sit home again, and or whatever it is. You're going to be most miserable if it's only about the here and now. It's not about the here and now only. And that's what the scripture is saying. Romans 1, verse 3. Putting away sin, self-control, is always also seen in the context of what's coming in the future. Romans 13, verse 11. It says, and do this, knowing the time, that now is high time to wake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness. Let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision of the flesh to fulfill its lusts. That concept is self-control. What does it give you the reason to do this for? What is coming? There is a purpose of why you are denying some of these things. Are you just here to be miserable on earth and only look at what's going on around you? Or is there something happening that's bigger, the future? It says our salvation's nearer than we first believed. It's coming quickly. The night's far spent. Let's walk properly. And one thing that I won't be able to cover in this sermon, which we'll do in another one, is this idea here. Is it says, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ. When we talk about self-control, again, when we just white-knuckle it, we're going to fail. We're going to fall on our face. We're going to try, and we will fail. And as Paul said, oh, wretched man that I am. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ is some other thing that's forward-moving, forward-looking. Not just resist. We do resist. But it says put on something and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. It's a two-pronged thing. Yes, resist, but put on something. I won't cover that here, but there is a big key in this to overcoming. Otherwise, we get stuck in a cycle. We fail. We fall. Don't like ourselves. You know, keep doing it over and over and over. We try. There are a lot of things in the Bible that talk about putting on things. So this, again, though, is talking about in the context of what's coming. You know, our salvation's close. It says, let's cast off some of this stuff. Let's put on the armor of light. Cast off, put on is what it says. So it's said in the context of what's coming. Turn over to 1 Peter 2:11. A vision of the future also includes this thought. 1 Peter 2:11. I think this is an interesting one. This is an interesting thing to think about when you're in the middle of something that you need to work through. It says 1 Peter 2:11. It says, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, so just saying those who are, in the Bible terms, those who aren't called, that when they speak against you as evildoers, that they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. This is 100% future-looking scripture. It says, you abstain from these things. Everybody's out doing something, and you say, you know what, I'm not going to. Your conduct is honorable with these people today. You know what they're going to do to you? You know what they'll say about you? It says right there, they will speak against you as evildoers. What is wrong with you? You have no fun? Why are you judging me? You know, whatever else it will be, they will speak of you as evildoers because you abstain. Oh, are you better than me? Oh, you think you're whatever it is. But what it says is that they may. You have these good works today, which they observe, one day Christ will come back. One day everybody will stand. One day, you know what's going to happen? they will remember that. Not today. They will malign you today. That's what it says. They're going to speak evil of you. One day, when it all comes to pass, they will remember what you did. And they will glorify God. And God will be glorified by this. This is a great scripture to think about. This is future looking. If you're struggling with something, you need a reason for it. Just think, okay, they're not going to get it today. I'm getting crucified here today. But one day, when this flips around, it'll be an amazing thing where they go, wow, that's why you did it. There'll be respect for that, but then there will be glory to God. And they'll say, wow, teach us more of this way. You will help somebody come to God. Not right now. Not right now. But you will one day. That's what it says. If you firmly don't have that picture in your mind about the future, then it's easy just to cave into the things, isn't it? Again, the Bible gives us some really hard-hitting, big things that could help in serious ways to have self-control that isn't just white-knuckling it. Know who you are. Have a vision of where the future, what the future is. And another one to remember is turn over to 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10. This one always stops me in my tracks when I really think about this. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10 says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of God, Christ, that each one may receive the things done in this body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are well known to God, and I also trust are well known to your consciences." And I'll just quote Matthew 12, 36 says, "But I say to you that every idle word men speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment." When I read those, I go, oh boy. Oh boy. That is a future-looking thing to think about. We're all going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and we're going to account for our words in our actions. And that should make us pause and think, do I want to show up ashamed, or do I want to show up and, you know, not because I'm good or anything, but, you know, not be so embarrassed about everything? And that's what it says. You have to think about what's coming in the future. Otherwise, there's no reason to be self-control. We'll be miserable in this life. Everybody else is having fun, and I'm not. But if you know what's coming, and like it says, we give up these things. We put them away. We know what's happening. We know one day the Gentiles will respond and go like, whoa, that's why you did it. Turn over to Acts 24, verse 24. Acts 24, verse 24. So what's coming is a judgment. We'll be accountable for our words. We also know that if we get ridiculed today by the, you know, those who aren't called, that one day it will flip it the other way and they will go, wow, that was great, and it'll glorify God. We find that the gospel message of Christ contained this, and these things are strung together. Acts 24, verse 24. It says, "After some days when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith of Christ. Now, as he reasoned about righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come, Felix was afraid." And he said, go away, I'll call for you and we'll, you know, bring it back up. But can you see that the part of the message that was said, it's about righteousness, it's about self-control, and it's about the future. And these are reasons, and they are mixed together with the gospel message of Christ. They are part of it. Paul preached it. It is about self-control. We do these things, but we also have a judgment to come, and we are going to be judged on these things as well. So every time we think about self-control, we need to understand it in the context of the future. We have to understand in the context of the future. And is it worth it? Is it worth it? You're going to give up some stuff. You will. John 12, 25 has a riddle. I love in the Bible that there's riddles here and there. This is one. John 12, verse 25. John 12, 25. If you were just an average person not understanding the plan of God, this would be a riddle. It says, "He who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life." Sounds like a riddle. But from what we just said, what's the reason for us to have self-control is we look and see a future We know there's something there, and it better be worth it. Because he who loves this life, you just indulge in this life, what will you lose? You will lose that one. But he who hates this life and sacrifices some of these things in this world will keep eternal life. Firmly have to plant that vision in your head. Otherwise, you're just resisting the flesh here and now. You have to know why and where you're going and what the future is. This is a key, a huge key. When you reread scriptures of self-control, when you reread putting away sin in these things, they always talk about somewhere around who you are and what your future is. That's the context of why you do. So we follow the Bible's cues. It has scripture after scripture that say that you must understand who you are, that you're a king, that you don't do those things. And secondly, that this has to be worth it. Otherwise, it's just miserable because you give up some of these things. So to be self-controlled, we have to have a vision of the future. Last point in this is a lack of self-control when you have it. You will be easily controlled by others. And you will actually become a weapon of destruction. When you lack self-control, you will be controlled by others. And you will actually become a weapon of destruction to other people. Turn back to Genesis 4, verse 1. Genesis 4, verse 1. This story is exactly that point to a T. And God saying it. Genesis 4, verse 1. It says, "Now Adam knew his wife, Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, and said, 'I have acquired a man from the Lord.' Then she bore again, this time a brother, Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. And Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell." What is Cain giving into? Cain is giving into a pull, a lust of the flesh. Lust of the flesh isn't just drink and drugs and things like that. Lust of the flesh is your emotions out of control. Anger is one of them. This is a big draw. People feed off of this. People get energy from this. And then God said in verse 6 to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and its desire is for you. But you should rule over it." There's a battle that was taking place here. There's a battle that's taking place here. It says its desire is for you. Its desire means it wants to rule over you. It wants to control you. If you do not control your anger, if you do not deal with this, sin lies at the door, and it will rule and control you. But you should have self-control over it. You should rule over it. You see the choice that God put before him. It says, look, this is not just, hey, obviously the murder and all these other things in this picture are incredibly wrong, but he's talking to him about how he's going to be controlled. He's going to end up being controlled, but you should control it. That's what he said. In verse 8, Cain went and talked to his Abel brother, and it came to pass when in the field, Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and he killed him. And the Lord said to Cain, where's Abel? And he says, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out for me from the ground. So now you're cursed from the earth, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. And then he gave him what's going to happen to him. This is an incredibly important point here. If you don't rule over it, sin lies at the door, and its desire will be it will rule you. You become the slave. When he lost self-control, what happened here? When he did not have self-control, he became a weapon of destruction against another human being. He actually killed somebody. He actually did not control his lusts, his desires, and self-control and the things that were there, to where he ended up becoming a tool of destruction against his brother. You know, it could be a hard story here, right? Because Abel was righteous. And God talked it through with Cain, and he tried to get him to get control over the desires. But when he went down the path of not controlling, and it led to sin, that sin ruled over him. That sin led to him being a tool of destruction. We may ask the question ourselves, how could somebody in our own church kill somebody? This is exactly how. The desires and the self-control and the lusts and the other things that are there, if they're not ruled over, sin lies at the door. That sin will rule over that person. That person carrying that out ends up being a tool of destruction. Don't let it surprise you that that happens. Can happen, has happened, did happen recently. And it's sin and not controlling those desires leads to this and turning into a weapon of destruction. Therefore, it's important for us to understand how critical it is when we talk about self-control of these things to remember this story of Cain and Abel. Because how could somebody who knows the truth end up killing somebody? Because they did not have self-control. It did lead to sin. That sin ruled over. And that ruling over turned the person into a weapon of destruction. Exactly what happened with Cain and Abel to a T. Can happen. Don't let it surprise you, because the Bible talks about it. This is a horrific example here. There's horrific examples we've had. There's other things that take place with people that are horrific as well. But the Bible talks about the core behind and how the process happens. And he became this tool of destruction. Turn over to 2 Timothy 2:22. 2 Timothy 2, verse 22. It says, flee also youthful lusts, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. But avoid foolish and ignorant disputes, knowing that they generate strife. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient, in humility, correcting those who are in opposition. If God perhaps will grant them repentance, so that they may know the truth, and that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to do his will. A lot of words that are there, but talking about putting out the lust, putting out the disputes, and all those other things that are pulls of the flesh. Because there's people that when they're in the snare. There's a snare that's there. These things are put before you, not just because, oh yeah, they're fun, let's just do that. Satan wants to capture you. Captive. You're captured. Now, you know what happens? He's manipulating you. Wants to do something, just kind of tweaks you, and then you become captive of him to do what he wants. This is where not having self-control leads to. You think you're free. You think you're living it up. You think you're doing great. You're actually taken captive and end up doing the will of not God. End up doing evil. We become weapons of unrighteousness in the wrong hands when we don't control these things. I mean, think about that. Think about these things. It's not just about you. We end up destroying other people. We end up destroying other things. We end up destroying groups when we don't ourselves have that control, because we can be tweaked. We can be manipulated. Proverbs 25:28 is this exact idea. It's in the New Testament, it's in the Old Testament, and it's a very powerful thought. This is one of my favorite scriptures of the Bible. There's a few that just jump out. This one I love. Proverbs 25:28 says, whoever has no rule over his own spirit is like a city broken down without walls. What does that mean? What kind of a city broken down without walls means? It's defenseless. A city without walls is defenseless. When you don't control yourself, we think, hey, this is just me. I'm expressing myself, or I'm, living. I'm really living life now. But what this says, if you don't rule over your spirit, you can easily be captured. You can easily be manipulated. Other people can control you like that. Because you're defenseless. You're not getting a grip on controlling yourself. At some point, you actually have to realize that your lack of self-control is what's causing you to be manipulated and be controlled. You control yourself. You're putting up walls in the context of this scripture is like walls of defenses of a city. You're not like a city that when an army comes upon it, the walls have all broken and fallen down and they just walk right in and capture it. If you get angry quickly and you don't control that, guess what's going to happen? Somebody's going to press your button. And what are you going to do? You're going to react. You're going to be manipulated. You may feel like you're, man, I'm just writing some wrong, but you're being manipulated. You're being controlled. You want power? You don't deal with that? Well, someone will come along and see that, and they'll put you in an inner circle. And you'll be part of the elite, and they'll keep holding out a carrot for you. You're manipulated again. If you understand the concept here, is we have to control ourselves, otherwise we become manipulated. Our walls are broken down. Army marches in, takes you over in 2 seconds. Therefore, self-control, we need to understand, is not a negative thing. It is an idea of strength. It's an idea of having strength. If you're not that confident, if you're looking for strength in life, if you need to have more self-confidence, self-control is a way to get there. Because when you are, you're like a city, strong. Not easy just to people to run right into, run right over, and then get manipulated and just moved all over the place by anybody else, whatever they want to do. You, unless you get a grip on this, are not strong yourself. You want strength. You want confidence. Self-control is one of those things that will allow you not to be easily manipulated, controlled, not have your city walls just run over by anybody and everybody that comes by. So underneath self-control, the idea that's really important to understand is that if you lack self-control, you are going to be easily controlled by other people, by Satan to do his will even, and become a weapon of destruction. Examples in the Bible, modern day example today, I think you know what I'm talking about, just happened, exactly that. You want to find strength, self-control is underneath. Self-control is underneath. So, I hope some of this helps to frame it a little bit differently, because self-control, again, like it says, it's not just a matter of, man, everybody's having fun and I'm just white-knuckling and I'm just bored over here, boring. It's not that. Self-control has at the root, when talked about in the Bible, there's 3 things to know about it. One, to be self-controlled, you have to know who you are. You have to know who you are, who your father is, who your king is, that you are a king. So that you can say the same phrase, I cannot do what you asked for I was born to be a king. And 2, to have self-control, you have to have a vision of what's coming. The white throne judgment, that eternal life is the reason why you're doing that. Otherwise, it's a miserable life. And that one day, the people that ridicule you because maybe you said no this time or you didn't quite indulge, they ridicule you today. But one day that will glorify God and they will turn and say, wow, show me more of that. And lastly, it's important to understand that a lack of self-control, if you have a lack of self-control, you will easily be controlled. You will easily be manipulated. You will easily just bounce all over the place and you become a weapon of destruction yourself. But self-control, underneath, you can find strength. So, that's next in the formula, finding self-control, and I hope we can understand a little bit better how it fits and the reasons why and how we should think about it. It requires that vision. It requires that vision for us to really do it. So let's add self-control.